The building of a church on the west shore does occupy your pastor's mind, together with the building of a church on the east shore, plus a well going dry, and trying to schedule 16 masses each Sunday. All this would possibly produce a gray hair if it were not for the splendid cooperation he is getting from the lay people. In many ways, they ease the burden and expend themselves in helping the whole program. The cooperation being shown on the west shore by Mr. Williams' committee is very encouraging. However, theirs is not an easy task. They go from house to house, literally begging for the sake of the new church. They are bound to become tired and even a little discouraged. We must do all we can to help Mr. Williams and his entire team in their self-sacrificing work of raising funds. To encourage them in the best possible fashion, we must be prepared not to dismiss them with small donations, but to give in the spirit of sacrifice, realizing that we must raise $150,000 in addition to what we have. Our summer friends, as well as permanent residents, are asked to sign pledge cards this week if they have not done so already. Those were the words of Father Francis McGowan, pastor of Our Lady of the Lake Church, addressing his parishioners in 1957. Father McGowan certainly had a lot on his plate. Let's take a few minutes and see how Father McGowan arrived at this point in history. In 1888, St. Michael Parish in Netcong established its first mission church on the shores of Lake Hopatcong in Mount Arlington. This church was Our Lady of the Lake. St. Bernard Parish of Mount Hope established a mission church on Lake Hopatcong in 1910 at Nolan's Point. This was Star of the Sea Church, which beginning in 1925 was staffed by priests from Seton Hall College. With a continued growth in summer populations around Lake Hopatcong, St. Michael established a second mission church in 1924, this time in the borough of Hopatcong at the intersection of River Styx Road and Lakeside Boulevard. Known as St. Joseph's Church, it operated only in summer months, and at times its altar was adorned with flowers from the garden of the nearby Hudson Maxim Estate. The church was located on the current site of the playground of Hudson Maxim School. In 1932, another St. Joseph Church was constructed, this time in the northwood section of Hopatcong. As was the case with Star of the Sea and St. Joseph's River Styx, this northwood church was only operational in the summer months. St. Joseph's Church Northwood was staffed by priests from Seton Hall College, as was the case for the nearby Star of the Sea Church. So, by the early 1930s, there were four Roman Catholic churches around Lake Hopatcong. One year-round church, Our Lady of the Lake in Mount Arlington, and the three summer-only mission churches, St. Joseph, River Styx, Star of the Sea at Nolan's Point, and St. Joseph, Northwood. In 1938, Our Lady of the Lake, previously a mission church of St. Michael's Parish in Netcong, was promoted to parish status and assumed control of the summer-only mission church St. Joseph River Styx. This same year, the Diocese of Paterson was formed from the Diocese of Newark. This resulted in the withdrawal of the Seton Hall College priests from the summer-only mission churches at Nolan's Point and Northwood. As a consequence, the newly formed Our Lady of the Lake Parish in Mount Arlington became the steward of three mission churches around Lake Hopatcong under the leadership of Father John Brady, the first pastor of Our Lady of the Lake Parish. Early in the morning, Valentine's Day, 1948, under the weight of a heavy snow, the roof of St. Joseph's Church at River Styx collapsed. This tragic event, together with the continued population growth of the borough of Hopatcong, would be the major catalyst for the eventual construction of a new church on the west shore of Lake Hopatcong, St. Jude Church. While fundraising efforts were undertaken in the years shortly after the roof collapse, totaling $3,400 by 1956, St. Joseph's River Styx Church was never rebuilt, most likely due to physical limitations of the site, including the lack of parking. Lake Hopatcong and the borough of Hopatcong were very different places in the first half of the 20th century than they are today. Post-World War II, Lake Hopatcong was evolving from a hotel resort area to a place of second homes and bungalows. In the early 1950s, Hopatcong had about 1,200 permanent residents, with its summertime population increasing by more than a factor of 10, and at times approaching 20,000 people. Special bus service was provided to the residents in Hopatcong Hills to ferry people both to the lake and to church services. This seasonal population explosion placed enormous pressures on the services and infrastructure of the area, including the Catholic Church. During the same period, it is estimated there were no more than 90 Catholic families living year-round in Hopatcong. Compare that to today, with well over 1,000 registered families at St. Jude. During the years following the roof collapse of St. Joseph Church, River Styx, masses were held at numerous locations within the borough of Hopatcong, including at Camp Tegawitha on the west shore of Lake Hopatcong, adjacent to the state park. Camp Tegawitha was a Catholic girls' summer camp established by the Archdiocese of Newark in 1925. Mass was held in the main building of the camp, which served as the chapel, dining hall, and recreation center. Camp Tegawitha was the last operating camp on Lake Hopatcong, closing its doors in the late 1970s. In the summer months, Mass was also held at the Hopatcong Hills and Heights clubhouses, a tradition that continued well into the 1960s. Off-season, Mass was held at the Madhouse, adjacent to the River Styx Bridge. Also known as Anderson's Pavilion for a period of time in the 1930s, this popular tavern and dance hall was a much quieter place in the winter months. At least we hope that was the case during church services. During the 1950s, Father Julian Finley, a retired Franciscan priest whose sister had a home in the Heights, would often say Mass for the faithful at the Madhouse. Father Finley was a very popular individual, and reportedly devoted to St. Jude Thaddeus. Some believe it was the popularity of Father Finley, both with year-round and summer residents, and his devotion to St. Jude Thaddeus that influenced the selection of St. Jude as the name for our church. A testament of the popularity of Father Julian Finley is seen today in the large stained glass window that sits above the altar of St. Jude Church. This window, which depicts St. Jude curing King Abagaro of Edessa from leprosy with an image of the face of Christ, is dedicated to Father Finley, courtesy of the St. Jude Ladies Guild. The Hudson Maxim School was also used for Mass during the 1950s. In addition to Camp Tegawitha, the Hopatcong Hills and Heights clubhouses, and the Madhouse. In the summers of 1956 and 57, a tent was erected for church services. In 1956, a 50 by 100 foot tent was placed on the current site of St. Jude Church. In 1957, the tent was located in the Elba Point section of Hopatcong, near Ithanel Road. In this photo, we see James McGinnis kneeling, a member of the St. Jude Men's Club, an organization that was very instrumental in fundraising for the new church. Also shown is John Collins, third man standing from the left, who was a member of the Mount Arlington Council of the Knights of Columbus. Tragically, in the afternoon of Sunday, August 13th, 1956, the wooden church on Nolan's Point Road burned to the ground. Our Lady, Star of the Sea Church was no more. So, we have come full circle. When the seemingly happy priest, Father Francis McGowan, took over as pastor of Our Lady of the Lake Parish from Father Joseph Duffy in 1957, he inherited a parish that was down not one, but two churches. If anyone needed help from the patron saint of hopeless causes, St. Jude, it was Father McGowan and his parishioners. The church fundraising campaign kicked off in earnest in 1957 with the formation of the St. Jude Men's Club under the leadership of George Williams and the St. Jude Ladies Guild led by Rita Sullivan. The official campaign kicked off on Sunday, July 28, 1957, with the blessing of the grounds and the campaign volunteers. The door-to-door campaign included several participation options, including a memorial plan, which allowed a loved one to be memorialized by church furnishings, such as pews, statues, windows, candle holders, and stations of the cross. Memorial gifts ranged from $25 to $5,000. A special appeal was made to summer residents, noting that a larger church was needed specifically to accommodate the large influx of summer parishioners. The summer church-going populations were on the order of six times that of year-round parishioners. In addition to the fundraising campaign led by the St. Jude's Men's Club, other fundraising efforts were undertaken, including picnics, bake sales, and card parties. Of course, what church event would be complete without a 50-50 drawing? Shown here is Ladies Guild member Alice Dwyer and Men's Club member James McGinnis picking the winning ticket. The teenagers also got into the church fundraising act by holding weekly barn dances under the tent at Elba Point. On Thursday, July 23, 1957, country and rockabilly singer Marvin Rainwater was the featured performer. Marvin Rainwater was a well-known performer of the time, having appeared on the Arthur Godfrey's Talent Scouts show in 1955. He also had appearances on the Ed Sullivan Show and American Bandstand. Mr. Rainwater continued performing well into the 2000s and now resides in Minnesota. Also in 1957, as a precursor to the construction of the church, a St. Jude shrine was constructed and placed at the Elba Point tent site. In the fall of 1957, the shrine was moved to the St. Jude church site, where it remained until 1978, when it was replaced by the St. Jude Shrine of today, located adjacent to the parish center. This is a photo of St. Jude Church under construction, taken in late 1958 or early 1959. Ground was broken for the new church in the fall of 1958. The original design included a lower level, but this was abandoned when excessive rock ledge was encountered. Church designs for St. Jude and Star of the Sea, being constructed at the same time, were therefore swapped, with Star of the Sea having the lower level. So if you want to see what St. Jude Church was originally intended to look like, visit Our Lady, Star of the Sea Church. In this photo, we see the interior of the church under construction. The church was designed to seat 460, although at the time of its construction there were only 90 year-round families. The bulk of its capacity was needed to accommodate summer parishioners. The church design was considered contemporary, with a fieldstone sanctuary wall. Underfloor radiant heating was used. This heating system was replaced in the late 1980s with a forced air heating and cooling system. The side walls are constructed with a rose-tinted brick. The cathedral ceiling is constructed with sugar pine. Note the windows are clear glass. The stained glass windows were added gradually over time, with the large stained glass window above the altar not ordered until October of 1962. Also note the primary church lighting is from fixtures attached to the ridge beam of the church. The hanging lights we see in today's church were added by Father Ryan in the 1970s to provide better lighting. The first Mass held in the new St. Jude Church was on Easter Sunday, 1959. Shown here is a Mass in early 1959 with a largely completed church interior, minus the stained glass windows. Also missing are the statues and the large crucifix above the main altar. The original configuration of the sanctuary included two side altars in addition to the main altar. Also notice the beautiful wrought iron communion railing, a typical feature of churches from this period. Note too the number of hats being worn by the congregation. The left side altar and tabernacle were later removed. A closer look at the main altar reveals its pre-Vatican II position. Following the recommendations set forth by the Second Vatican Council, main altars were pulled forward and reversed to face the congregation. This reconfiguration probably took place sometime in the late 1960s. Also notice the design of the double gate of the communion rail, with its chalice and host design. The altar rails remained in place until December 9, 1985. The altar railings were removed by parishioners in a special ceremony held by Father Panos, shown here, and Father Oliveri. Rumor has it that sections of the altar railing found their way into homes within Hopatcong. On August 16, 1959, Bishop McNulty dedicated St. Jude Church. In fact, both St. Jude and Star of the Sea churches were dedicated by the bishop on the same day. First St. Jude and then Star of the Sea. Following the Star of the Sea dedication, a parish-wide dinner celebration was held in the lower level of the Star of the Sea church. Both churches were mission churches of Our Lady of the Lake Parish. But now the parish had two additional year-round churches, and not merely summer-only churches. Part of the dedication ceremony included the laying of the church cornerstone. Here the cornerstone is on the lower right of the screen, not yet slid into position on the exterior front wall of the church. Bishop James McNulty is seen here applying the mortar to the cornerstone, with Father McGowan to his right. Finally, we see the cornerstone slid into position on the exterior front wall of the church, where it remains today. In case you are wondering, we have no information as to whether any time capsule material may have been placed behind the cornerstone. The church was designed with a seating capacity of 460, and from the looks of it, every seat was taken during the dedication service. Notice that the crucifix is now in place above the main altar, and the church walls are abundantly adorned with many statues. This shot also provides a nice view of the chalice and host design of the altar railing gate. Here we see the recessional of the dedication service, led by the Mount Arlington Council of the Knights of Columbus. St. Jude established their own Knights of Columbus Council in the mid-1980s. Shown here following the dedication are Father Julian Finley, left front, and Father Bernard Pruzak, who was a transitional deacon at the time of this photo. Bernard Pruzak was a local resident who at the time was about to depart for Rome to complete his seminary studies. On July 14, 1963, he said his first Mass as a priest at St. Jude. Behind Father Finley and Father Pruzak are the knights who participated in the service. In row one is Richard Williams, son of George Williams, the president of the St. Jude's Men's Club, Lou Ferrara, John Collins, Bill Dwyer, and George Davis. In row two is John Darcy, Anthony Taylor, Jerry Strubeck, Bill Polidori, Bob Guggen, and Fred Coos. One final look at the completed church exterior, with its steeple of twin stone columns rising high above the roof line, capped with a triangular pediment decorated with a symbol of the Holy Spirit. In the opening between the steeple columns are three large crosses. Sadly, this original steeple was destroyed during a strong storm in February of 1976. The remaining upright portions of the steeple were so unstable that it was opted not to rebuild the steeple, but rather cap the twin stone columns at the roof line and extend the roof structure outward along the peak, resulting in the church exterior that we know today. Finally, a small statue of St. Jude sits above the church entrance. Interestingly, the discarded fieldstone from the destroyed steeple was used to create the current St. Jude Shrine, which was dedicated in 1978. So as the old saying goes, when life serves you lemons, make lemonade. In the years following the 1959 dedication, the church continued to grow in faith and prosper in numbers. As a mission church of Our Lady of the Lake Parish, the church supported the construction of the parish school in Mount Arlington in 1960, providing on the order of $85,000 towards its construction costs. Organizations like the Men's Club and the Ladies Guild continued to grow and support the needs of the church. The Ladies Guild continued holding their annual communion breakfasts, raised scholarship funds for youths going to Catholic high school, held bake sales, sold religious articles after Mass, and continued their annual August card party. The Ladies Guild continued to function until 1973, with Jane Wood serving as its last president. Many of its members then made the transition to the St. Jude Rosary and Altar Society, formed in 1974 with Florence Wakefoos as its first president. The Mission Church St. Jude was elevated to parish status on September 15, 1966, with Father Joseph Malloy as its first pastor. At the same time, St. Joseph Northwood became a Mission Church of St. Jude Parish and operated as such until it was closed in 1976. St. Joseph Northwood was later demolished and a private residence exists on the site today. One remaining keepsake from this 1932-era church is found in the St. Jude rectory of today. Hanging in the foyer of the residential side of the rectory are these two lights, removed from St. Joseph's at the time of its closing. Speaking of rectories, in 1966, St. Jude did not have a building that could serve as a rectory. So as a consequence, the Basile House, located on what is now the property of the Westside Methodist Church, served as the parish rectory. Shown here in a 1994 photo is that building. The basement level served as a business office, with the residential quarters upstairs. The building was later sold and served as the parsonage for the Westside Methodist Church, but has since been demolished. On January 26, 1973, Father Brendan Ryan was appointed pastor of St. Jude Parish. Father Ryan was well known to the St. Jude parishioners, as he had served as assistant pastor at Our Lady of the Lake Parish in the early 1960s, and served as counselor to the St. Jude's Ladies Guild during this same period. Priests that were with the parish during Father Ryan's tenure included Father Louis Holterhoff and Father Patrick Panos, shown here in a 1979 photo. Father Panos would later become the third pastor of St. Jude Parish. Father Holterhoff was a very popular priest, especially with the youth of the parish. This motorcycle-riding priest had an identical twin brother who was also a priest. As you might imagine, confusion would abound on those occasions when Father Holterhoff's twin visited St. Jude Parish. Father Ryan's 12-year tenure as pastor occurred during the peak growth period of Hopatcong, and he was responsible for some of the greatest physical changes to the parish, including the construction of the rectory on the church property and the construction of the parish center. Here we see the parish rectory and parish center well under construction in the summer of 1974. The completed rectory and parish center are shown in these January 1975 photos. Notice the parish center landscaping, including the stairs, are now completed. Those small evergreens sure have grown up in 30 years. Father Richard Oliveri joined St. Jude Parish in 1980 upon the departure of Father Holterhoff to St. Joseph in Mendham. This photo of today's church shows the area that was once the choir loft, now hidden from view by the pipe organ facade and swell shutters. In the early years of the church, the choir and organ were located in the loft. Sometime in the 1960s, it was decided that the choir and organ belonged in the sanctuary, and from that point forward, the choir loft area of the church was largely unused, except for accommodating overflow crowds. This photo shows the organ located in the sanctuary, in the position where the left side altar was once found. On June 11, 1985, Father Patrick Panos became the third pastor of St. Jude Parish, having been associate pastor since 1974. That same year, Father John McGuigan joined St. Jude Parish. On October 21, 1988, the church's current organ, a 1924 Griffith Beach Theater organ, was dedicated. With the help of the Garden State Theater Organ Society, the organ was rescued by Father Panos and his brother Peter from the Elliott Street School in Newark, where it had fallen into disrepair, having been damaged by water in 1969. Donated to St. Jude by the Elliott Street School PTA in 1985, it underwent an extensive renovation totaling $40,000. Funds for its repair were provided by Father Panos, his brother Peter, and from donations of parishioners and friends of St. Jude Parish. The organ was originally dedicated by the Elliott Street School to 15 graduates who lost their lives in World War I. It was donated to St. Jude with the understanding that the parish would be a good steward to the organ and the memories it honors. In its 1988 rededication, these lost World War I souls were remembered, as well as the deceased parents, relatives, and loved ones of the parishioners and friends of St. Jude Parish. While most parishioners only know the St. Jude pipe organ from the console that sits in the front of the church, it is called the pipe organ for a reason. The former choir loft is now the repository for over 1,000 wooden and metal pipes. Pipes are arranged into ranks with varying diameters and lengths. The longer the pipe, the lower the resulting pitch. The original wooden outer shell of the organ's console was replaced as part of the 1988 renovation, although the original mahogany color can still be seen on the console's keyboard. Father George Gothy became the fourth pastor of St. Jude Parish in 1990. In 2001, a prayer garden was constructed on the grounds of the church, on the wooden property to the right of the church building, adjacent to the rectory. The prayer garden was a result of an Eagle Scout project of Patrick Campbell of Troop 88, a troop sponsored by St. Jude's Knights of Columbus. At the entrance to the prayer garden is a monument created to honor unborn children, which was erected in remembrance of Bill Romano, a deceased St. Jude knight. The unborn monument was created in a joint effort between the St. Jude Council of the Knights of Columbus and Eagle Scout Jeff Moser. At the beginning of the prayer garden's meditation path is a monument dedicated to mothers, and specifically to the mother of Father George Gothy, Julia Gothy. Since its creation, parishioners and Troop 88 Scouts have maintained and added elements to the prayer garden. In 2003, Father Gothy accepted a donation of a large wooden statue of St. Jude, carved by a man from Minnesota. Received in some disrepair, the hard work of a dedicated group of parishioners helped restore the statue to its original glory. In 2008, in recognition of the 50th anniversary of the construction of St. Jude Church, the oldest living Rosarian, Josie Hartman, is shown here presenting Father George Gothy the proceeds from the Rosary and Altar Society's annual Tricky Tray fundraiser.